Well, that sounds like a great thing that you started this blog, because currently with the pandemic, as you said, more and more players are using the games as a means of relaxing, and basically it is a very good idea.
Hello, sir. I see you've already found a cow.
A cow? It's huge!
I guess you guys could start with telling me about yourselves, like what you guys do at the company, and I know you're the CEOs or the management, it said.
Well, basically we both met at the Plovdiv Music School, at 8th grade, so this was like,
what was like 10 years
10
ago.
Years ago, yeah. The music school, and we started programming together. We started doing some website, mobile applications. Then we decided that we want to start doing games. We started creating some small mobile Android games. Actually, the first idea about Moonlander was to be a small mobile game. Back in the days, we were working on it. But the game became too big and a bit too boogie. Decided to stop the project, and a few years later we decided to start working again on it. But because we had these big epic ideas about the story and about the gameplay, we decided to go with for PC and consoles, and so we started working with on Unity. We started gathering team. This was back in 2017. We did a prototype level, so we can validate our ideas with the gamers. We went to a lot of different events so we can give the players the prototype so they can test it, and we can see which mechanics and features are good and which are bad and needs improvements. Back in 2018 we started gathering a team, we have artists from Romania, Colombia. We have a level designer from Canada, sound effects from the USA. We have a lot of people here from Bulgaria. So yeah, we are a pretty international team. And for the past 3.5 years, we are all working on the game. Right now it is in the final stages. So we have pretty much almost all the things implemented. And right now we are just polishing it, making it look nicer, play nicer, fixing the bugs, adding some extra multiplayer modes, and porting the game for consoles. Mm-hmm. So that's a quick overview of the last
Did you guys have to like change everything up during the pandemic and work from home, or you've been doing?
Well, we are very efficient at working remotely, because most of our team is...
Everyone is everywhere.
Comprised from people, from all over the world. We are six people here. But we have at least 6 more people in different countries, and we all work remotely and asynchronously. We are not online at the same time, so we got pretty used to this type of work.
And then you guys met in college, you said, in music.
In high school.
And then before that, what was it like? What were your early days with, like, how did you get into video games, or were you really obsessed with games as a kid and then you dropped off and then you came back to it?
You are really nailed that answer, because when we started with Moonlander, we wanted to make a game that plays nice and is interesting for Android, because we wanted to play games ourselves on Android, and it didn't have that much games back there. Mm-hmm. Basically. But by the time we finished Moonlander, the Android store was already full. And the game still had a lot more things that needed to be done in order to get it to a production state. So we decided to drop it and just get more experience.
Yeah.
So the difference between our first attempt and now is that now we had like maybe five years of experience only in the game industry, and maybe 8 or 9 years as programmers. So the second time we
more
started,
than 9 years,
more than 9 years.
13 years.
the second time we started, it was completely different. We started with the team, the concept, the validation from other people, which is extremely important for a big project like that. We built this structure that is good for expanding on different game features in the future, and we're very happy because that structure has held it for more than 4 years. The game is quite large currently, and it is well, not without its bugs, but there are a few and they are not global. They are only small bugs that we can fix easily.
Hamilton! This tree has hands!
It is not a tree, sir. It is a vine.
You guys studied programming then and got into games and taught yourself a bunch of the gaming stuff? Or
taught ourselves how to program because we started at pretty early stage. I started in creating websites at fourth grade. He started even earlier. And we didn't learn that in school or college. We were just learning that while doing projects. Mm-hmm. And,
I started also in college to get a computer's degree, but I'm even not sure if I will be able to finish it because of Moonlander, because this is just taking all of our time. And I don't even have time to go to the lectures and the final exams and stuff like that. Yeah, but basically the self-learning path was the most efficient for us because it allowed us to really progress very fast with the different aspects of programming and overall with the computers.
So you guys started working on the game by yourself, just the two of you as the mobile game, and then it just grew and grew into this big team?
Yeah, well, the first people that we added to the team were the artists, because we cannot draw. So we wanted a game. We were very inspired from games like Ori, the Ori series, and Rayman. So we wanted a game that kind of looks like that, with these beautiful art rich environments. And we definitely couldn't do that without artists. So we got this art concept artist from Colombia and our two main artists from Romania. And they started creating the art, and then we started adding programmers, level designers, and the other team members.
Yeah, actually the guy with the red t-shirt at the end of the office is the first programmer that joined our team here in Plovdiv, and we met him at a game jam. So he really suggests everybody that is trying to gather a team to go to these types
well,
of events.
Actually, our two other programmers, we met them at the game jam, the Plovdiv game jam as well. So definitely the game jams are a great place to meet people, to learn how the games are working, to see in just 2 days all the things that you need to be able to do to create a game, and to meet people that you can potentially work with. So yeah, they're definitely great, and every person that is into games or programming and wants to try creating games, just go to the local game jams, and they are great.
Did you grow up playing these type of games, like the shoot 'em ups?
Well, I think that we grew up playing all kinds of games.
Like
2D, 3D. I'm not into strategies,
I am. So when we take the group experience from both of us, we cover a very big spectrum of games.
Yeah.
But what I remember very vividly is when I played the first Ori game, I was absolutely amazed with the level of detail that it had for a game back in 2014. Mm-hmm. So actually we started Moonlander around the time that Ori came out, and we played it. This was the final push for us to start the development for PCs and consoles.
Yeah.
No, the backgrounds remind me of Ori, because I think I just finished Ori 2 right before E3.
Oh, yeah, it is even better than the first one, according to my opinion, at least.
Yeah.
It is amazing.
But the first one was the only game, because I usually play on console, but the first one was the only game I played on my PC, I think, that I've completed. Usually I try out games on PC and then I just go back to my PlayStation or Switch, but... No, it's a beautiful game, and listen to the music all the time.
It's a big inspiration for us, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that's one of your main inspirations, like for the art style?
Oh, yeah, definitely. And for the music.
And the music. So well, Ori is probably a big, like, memorable game for you because it got you to, like, choose a style for this, but what other games are big memorable games? Or,
well, I would say games like Hollow Knight or even like Guacamele, and I don't know, do you think of other games that we have talked?
Oh yeah, the Rayman series.
The Rayman series, Rayman. They are also
with the local multiplayer. There, yeah, it's a lot of fun.
They actually inspired us for the couch multiplayer because the Rayman series has one of the best couch multiplayer options in the 2D games market.
Well, actually, we are very big fans of the local multiplayer where you can just put a couple of controllers to the PC and start playing with your friends or family. And there are actually not that many games that are offering local multiplayer at all. Like, right now, I think that maybe if you have one game with local multiplayer are released per year, it is going to be great because we are constantly looking for local multiplayer games and there are like almost nothing new. So we decided that we definitely want to create that because we want these kind of games. And also there is not a big competition there because there are actually not a lot of local multiplayer games. And this is what is driving us to create a lot of different multiplayer modes, so you can have different experience. Like we have the PvP where you can play as a cow and combat the alien spaceships. You can play PvE where you are fighting the AI cow. We have this football multiplayer mode that we just created and we are going to stream during the PAX event this week. We are right now working on a wave survival mode where you have 10 waves of enemies that you need to survive. And we have a lot of different multiplayer modes lined up. So in the end, for the full release of the game next spring, we are going to have like around 6 or 7 multiplayer modes with each one of them with more than 20 maps and more than 20 skins for the character. So it is going to be pretty massive multiplayer.
And they are not only skins, they are actually playing a little bit differently. Yeah. So there are different options that you can try in each one of the modes.
Well, that's really cool. My during the pandemic, I got my girlfriend to play like Switch games with me, and we started with Overcooked 1 and 2, and we beat that in less than a month, I think. Yeah. And we're just looking for other games. We play Mario Kart, but there's not a lot of local multiplayer games.
Yeah, definitely. Well, we can give you one key for the multiple with the exclusive football multiplayer mode that we are developing right now.
Yeah,
it's not yet fully finished, but we can definitely give you a key, and we'll love to hear your feedback when you try it.
Yeah, no, it's fun to just like go to your friend's house even and take your Switch or whatever and play with friends. Yeah. Like I miss the days. I used to beat game when I was a kid. My friend would come over with like a bag of candy and a big soda, and we'd beat like a whole game in a weekend.
yeah.
Together.
Yeah.
What came first? Did you figure out you wanted to make this type of game, or did you think of the whole story with the cow, the demon cows in space, or was it like a mix?
we start talking about story. We actually had much bigger story in the beginning for Moonlander, and we had to cut it like 10 times in order to fit it in that first game.
Yeah, so, otherwise we are going to be developing that game for 10 years with the story that we have in our heads.
Yeah, in the current game you have like maybe 12 lethal abilities, and you have non-lethal and defense abilities. And these are not all of the abilities that we have currently came up with and have prototyped and are part of the story in the next possible DLCs and sequels that we could do if it turns out well.
And there's all the milk everywhere too, which is game's really funny.
You have cows, so you should have
milk. It's like milk shields and milk weapons. It's a lot of fun. Yeah.
More good news, sir. We found a milkerizer. We should restore our ship milk supply.
Yeah. The game's fun. Did you guys write the game? Like the comedy in the game and the humor? You have someone else?
Yeah,
all by you guys?
The story, we have a big voiceover. So the complete story, you have very small part in the demo, like you have a few conversations, but you cannot really understand the story there. Well, the idea of the demo is not to know the story, but in the game, the story is pretty big. There are a couple of big plot twists. We have like 5 different characters that are recorded from professional voice actors. So yeah, the story is pretty big.
And then what are your comedy influences, or what that got you?
Well, Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah, Guardians of the Galaxy is awesome. And the main hero is actually in character a lot. It is very similar to the Lander in Moonlander.
Yeah, this.
Damn! When did they manage to remove the parachutes on these things? Hamilton, some beast is looking at us. Shoo! It keeps getting closer. Hamilton!
Yeah, this the guy, the Star-Lord guy, that like, you know how he always
he's overconfident and always does what he wants.
Yeah, and he often does some dumb stuff, but he's super confident that this is the right thing to do. So our characters has our main character has the same
the same behavior. He is overconfident and he may do some stupid things from time to time, but he is also smart and always finds a way out of the situation, even if it's not the right one, but always some exit. So yeah, it is a very fun unravel of events in Moonlander. And not only fun, we took this fun concept of milk and cows and we built a very epic storyline with emotional plot twists inside. So there are times where you will not laugh, you will have a completely different.
And I remember there was like funny moments, or the narrator would say fun stuff.
Yeah, we also have these completely narrative cutscenes in a bit of a Diablo style, where Diablo 2 style, where the character talks over some slides that are appearing one after the other, with objects in the slides appearing with some effects. And it is very cool to learn more about the backstory, because these are the places where we talk more about what happened before you start playing the game.
Yeah, so you don't have this super linear experience and you constantly you get some information about the story before you start the game.
And I've been asking people from other countries what the gaming scene was like and how it's changed over the years, like since you were a kid in your country. But I know Dimitar from Life Slide told me there was a lot of piracy back in the day, and he would buy just like pirated versions of games. Well, but now that everything's digital, it's like easier to get stuff for everyone.
Yeah, well, still you have a lot of pirating here in Bulgaria because we are not of the richest country. So I think that's always with the countries that the standard is a bit low. Definitely here the standard is low. So you always have this pirating there. But I guess that this is normal, because if your salary is like 600 euros, you are not going to spend 60 on a game. No, this is 10% of your salary. So this is great.
That is exactly what I was going to say, that piracy, according to me, is okay for people that need to spend their money on food, basically, rent. So this is the only way, actually, for them to play those games. Even for our game, I won't mind if the people that cannot buy that game play the pirated version after some time, and maybe in the future they will have money and have the wish to buy the second one or something like that.
Yeah, we are not planning we are not planning to put some crazy defenses that are protecting the game from piracy. So if you want to download the game from some online torrent tracker, it's okay.
No, but it's a big deal too that since anyone can release a game digitally, I guess that you can send it like everywhere.
Yeah,
which is cool, instead of just trying to get it out in your area, or
definitely.
Or trying to get a game printed.
It's a lot better times for game development right now, and you have all these engines like Unreal Engine, Unity, and a lot of ours, and you have these plugins, and you can very easily start developing. Just look at some online courses, get your programming skills up to date, and start building games, and you can release it worldwide. So it's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Actually, with all of these negative emotions around the coronavirus, it has one little bright side, that it actually allowed the developers to attend these big conferences, the indie developers like us, because if it were for it weren't for the coronavirus, these conferences were never meant to be held online. They are
we wouldn't be able to
go to California.
The tickets and to go to California and to get a physical stamp, it would be a lot more pricey. And with the online events, we can basically attend almost all of them, because you don't have to spend crazy money on tickets and plane tickets and hotels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I talked to someone else about that before. Like, if it wasn't the coronavirus and the pandemic and an online E3, would you be there? And they said no. Like, but it's helped, because then they had smaller games talking to a lot of people and getting their games out there.
Yeah, definitely.
So that's really pretty cool.
Yeah. And the indie show, you guys were in the indie showcase?
Yeah.
I think that was one of the strongest like presentations, because it just showed game after game, and they were all really cool.
Yeah.
We wish for that presentation to have been a little bit longer, because after each game, the people that watch it don't even have the time to check that game out or open in a tab or something.
Like, there were around 10 or 15 games in just 30 minutes, mm-hmm. and it felt a bit rushed. It was great to be aired and broadcasted there. So we really hope that, for example, for the upcoming events, they're going to spend a little bit more broadcasting time for the indies, because there are really some great games there. That can be showcased, and it would be great to have the opportunity to show the game, basically to see the quality of the games there.
Mm-hmm. And you guys are doing PAX online now?
GDC next week.
Oh, that's online too.
And Gamescom, I think, next month.
Look at that crazy creature.
Hum, but one is not on my records.
It doesn't look very smart. It kind of reminds me of Sanders.
Usually you just done local stuff or the game jams more?
Only local Bulgarian events. We have participated in only one before the E3. I think it was EGX last year.
This
was the only big one that we attended, and it had a lot of positive feedback then. Mm-hmm. So we decided to just go for it this year and try to get the game to as much of an audience as we can. And we actually get really positive feedback on our Steam page, because we have we saw our ratios, retention ratios, and there were like 30-40%, which is crazy conversion from view to wish list. Which is great, and it means that we need more people to view our game, and this is why we are trying so hard to attend these conferences and spend our small indie budget in the smartest way possible for the game to reach its target audience.
Yeah, the exposure for the indie games is something very hard to do, because if you don't have a budget, you cannot advertise the game so easily. And with these online events, it is a great opportunity, because for relatively small price, you get a lot of exposure there, and you can reach out to some journalists, streamers, and people that's business meetings, like publishers and marketing agency that you can meet there. And this is something, a great opportunity for the indies, because otherwise we are just struggling to get 10 views on the page. Even if the game is great, when you don't have the money for marketing, it's very hard.
I started just writing like little opinion things and pieces and like my thoughts on games on my site. And then I think I asked someone through Twitter, Neil Jones, that he made the game Never Yield. That's like an endless runner. Mm-hmm. I just like messaged him to, if I could interview him to try this out, but it's been fun to talk to people and like show their game to people.
Here she is, Hamilton. What a coincidence. I'm ready to fight. Turn up the battle track.
Be gentle, sir.
Thank you guys for your time. And I'm really excited to play the game.
We will send you a key so you can try it. Yeah, and, let us know if you like it.
I tried the demo for, I guess, like an hour or 30 minutes the other day. But it was a lot of fun. Thanks for everything.
Yeah, it's just nice talking with you.
Yeah. All right.
Bye. Have a nice
bye.
Have a nice
All right. Have a good PAX and everything
Thanks.
Else.
Bye.
Bye.